Books on Tape presents A Slave No More, Two Men Who Escaped to Freedom, Including Their Own Narratives of Emancipation. Written by David Blight. Read by Arthur Morey and Dominic Hoffman.
By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, Sing us one of the songs of Zion. O daughter of Babylon, who art to be destroyed, happy shall he be that rewardeth thee as thou hast served us. Psalm 137. Before morning I had begun to feel like I had truly escaped from the hand of the slave master. I never would be a slave no more. John Washington, remembering his first night of freedom along the Rappahannock River. I now dreaded the gun and handcuffs and pistols no more, nor the blowing of horns and the running of hounds, nor the threats of death from the rebels' authority. Wallace Turnage, remembering his first hours of freedom on a sand island in Mobile Bay. Prologue. No man can tell the intense agony which is felt by the slave when wavering on the point of making his escape. All that he has is at stake, and even that which he has not is at stake also. The life which he has may be lost, and the liberty which he seeks may not be gained. Frederick Douglass, 1855. John Washington, a 24-year-old urban slave in Fredericksburg, Virginia, escaped across the Rappahannock River to Union Army lines in April 1862 by ingenuity, skillful deception, and courage. Through the chaos of war, he found his way to a tenuous freedom in Washington, D.C. Wallace Turnage, a 17-year-old slave born in North Carolina, ran away four times from an Alabama cotton plantation before he fled a Mobile slave jail on his fifth and final escape. In a harrowing and dramatic journey, he made his way on foot through swamps and snake-infested rivers to the safety of the Union Navy in Mobile Bay, in August 1864. Both Washington and Turnage wrote remarkable post-emancipation narratives of their flights to freedom. Both also lived remarkable post-emancipation lives as laborers and citizens in Washington and New York City. In publishing their narratives and reconstructing their life stories for the first time, this book illuminates anew one of the greatest dramas of the Civil War: the anguished and glorious liberation of 4 million American slaves from generations of bondage. Authors often spend years planning, researching, and outlining their books, but this book found me in a rather unusual way. In the spring of 2003, I was contacted by literary agent Wendy Strothman, who was working on behalf of Julian Houston, a writer and retired judge in Boston, who had inherited John Washington's writings and papers from his mother, Alice Jackson Stewart. Alice Stewart had been the best friend of Washington's granddaughter, Evelyn Easterly, who had saved and passed on her forebearer's writings. Wendy knew of my work on slave narratives, which have emerged in the past three decades as the founding texts of African American literature and an essential form of documentation for American slavery. Several years ago, I edited a new edition of the most famous slave narrative of all, Narrative of the Life of Frederick Douglass, an American Slave, written by himself. Wendy sent me a photocopy of Washington's narrative and asked me to read it with an eye for authenticity and significance. Months passed before I paid close attention, since I was preoccupied with other work and in the midst of a career move. In the fall of that year, Deborah Meckey, director of the Historical Society of the town of Greenwich, Connecticut, invited me to give a lecture to her board of trustees. At dinner before the lecture, Deborah asked me if I would be willing to have a look at what she and her staff believed to be an authentic slave narrative. It recently had been donated by Gladys Watts, a surviving friend of Wallace Turnage's daughter, Lydia Turnage Connolly, who had preserved the narrative in a special black clamshell box until her death in Greenwich in 1984. My initial response was, "Another one?" Residents of the town of Greenwich had owned small numbers of slaves in the late 18th and early 19th centuries, and now this wealthy small town had a former slave's dramatic story housed in their official heritage attic. When I finally sat down and carefully read the two narratives together, I realized with a thrill of discovery that what we possessed were two extraordinary, unpublished, and probably unmediated narratives about one of the most revolutionary transitions in American history. If the lives of these two men could be verified, we would have two original ways of seeing how American slaves achieved freedom in the Civil War. Post-emancipation narratives by ex-slaves that told the story of their liberation from bondage in the 1860s are rare enough. In my lifetime, a mere handful have surfaced, making these two untouched manuscripts very special. Judge Houston had placed the Washington narrative on deposit at the Massachusetts Historical Society in Boston for professional safekeeping. Wendy Strothman arranged for me to meet Houston, and through the good services of the MHS, I saw the original manuscript of the Washington narrative and its many accompanying documents and photographs. We also went to Greenwich to see the original Turnage manuscript. Then we arranged an agreement among all the parties that I would combine the two narratives in one volume and tell the stories of Washington and Turnage together, including whatever I could uncover about their post-war lives. In the case of Turnage's narrative, the HSTG had the wisdom to engage two people to work on the document before I was involved. Candice LaPrade, a literature professor at Tulane University, read the memoir and wrote a short essay placing it within the genre of slave narratives. Most important, the HSTG hired Christine McKay, an archivist at the New York Public Library's Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, to investigate Turnage's life after slavery. I, in turn, asked Christine to help me do the same for the post-slavery life of John Washington. Her dogged pursuit of the details of each man's life has been crucial to this book. With Christine's help, I have traced the post-emancipation lives of both Washington and Turnage. Their stories are both unique and representative. They are individual tales of freedom as well as two ways of seeing the whole epic of emancipation. They remind us that history is unpredictable, anguished, and hidden, but also sometimes patterned, triumphant, and visible in the quiet and turbulent corners of the lives of real people. When political disunion came and the war broke out in 1861, Northern free blacks and Southern slaves alike understood with varying degrees of fear and hope that their fate lay in the balance. They could imagine that the long prophesied break with a dark past was at hand. "At last our proud republic is overtaken," wrote the greatest black leader, Frederick Douglass, immediately after the firing on Fort Sumter in April 1861. "Now is the time to change the cry of vengeance long sent up from the toiling bondsmen into a grateful prayer for the peace and safety of the government." Despite the untold desolations the war might bring, Douglass now envisioned armed abolition conducted in a sanctioned war against the South. Above all, he saw the war as a crisis that bound up the fate of the republic and the fate of the slave in the same bundle. Such was the hope of 1861 for African Americans and their allies. But most Americans, in the Confederate South as well as in the Union North, did not see the war in Douglass's way. The scope, character, and purpose of the war were yet to be determined. Was it time for Southern independence and the creation of a new Confederate slaveholding nation? Or was it time for the rapid restoration of the Union by suppressing the insurrection with force and returning to the pre-war situation of coexisting slave and free states? Or, as blacks and their white abolitionist friends hoped, was it time for a revolution, a long war that would destroy slavery and reinvent a second American republic more inclusive than the first? What time was it? Throughout the war, in thousands of different circumstances, under changing policies and redefinitions of their status, and in the face of social chaos caused by huge military campaigns and destruction, 4 million slaves helped to decide what time it would be in American history. As W.E.B. Du Bois later wrote, "Of all that most Americans wanted from the war, this freeing of slaves was the last." But most slaves knew what they wanted out of the war. They sought a sense of independence. They wanted wages, dignity, family security and cohesion, freedom from a master's or an overseer's whims, and freedom from living as both property and the object of another person's will. They wanted release from white people's expectations, from a white man's lust or a white lady's daily needs. They wanted last names, recognition of their own humanity, and control of their children. They wanted labor and livestock that they truly owned. They wanted to live by a clock they themselves could set. They wanted to be, as Douglass once put it, more than a creature of the present and past, and craved a future with hope in it. As elusive as it was, the freedom most slaves sought was something they comprehended deep in their experience of its denial. So the freedom that most slaves imagined was both a long and painful process and a moment. The glorious jubilee foretold in their readings and hearings of biblical prophecy. They waited and chose carefully when and how to act, while sustaining their expectations of freedom against great odds. The exact time and location of deliverance, though, had never really been the point. Slaves managed fear with faith. Antebellum African American religion was one way people sustained hope of liberation in the face of whatever soul-killing events happened in their own lives. In 1859, a fugitive slave known only as NLS, who had just escaped through the efforts of Underground Railroad tactician William Still of Philadelphia.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.